very much, Priscilla, and thank you for that wonderfully generous introduction. It's one of the nicest introductions I've ever had, anyway. That includes a number of introductions by you and by others here at Hong Kong University. So, as Priscilla said, this is probably my last lecture in this series. I hope it's not my last lecture in any way at Hong Kong University. This is an institution that I'm very proud of being affiliated with. As Priscilla said, I go back in terms of some form of affiliation for almost 30 years at Hong Kong. In the last 10 years, first as a film examiner for the history department and then as an assistant professor. And it's something that I have enjoyed thoroughly. I've enjoyed meeting people who work here, the students who are here, meeting other people in Hong Kong. It has been a fantastic opportunity for me to get to know this city better and this institution better. And I really want to thank Hong Kong University for its friendship, its hospitality in bringing me in. And I hope this will be a lasting connection also after I've been on a lecture in this series. I have a few other things I want to say about Hong Kong later on, but I'll get to that at the end of my talk today. And then we can discuss it later on. But in addition to Hong Kong University and its wonderful staff, or at least the staff in the history department, which I thank especially Andy is here tonight, who's been organizing this series, as Priscilla said, in particular. But I also wanted to thank you, Priscilla, because of what you have done, not just for me when I've been a visiting professor here, but for everyone who's been coming visiting to the department over the years that you have been here. You have more or less single-handedly internationalized the subject of history at Hong Kong University. There are lots of very good historians here, lots of very good people in humanities and social sciences. And I think that the overall quality of people who teach here and research here increase year on year. But you have been very special in the sense that you have taken on many tasks in terms of linking your department up to the wider world, including to mainland China, which is particularly important. When I first came here, one of the things I was really struck by was how many fine people Hong Kong University had, still has, but how relatively few links there were between people in this city and those who really wanted to link up to on the mainland. And Priscilla has been among, and that's essential for this university's future, whatever way you look at it. And Priscilla has been among the ones who have taken the lead in changing that situation. And that is very, very important. And I also want to thank you for being such a wonderful person. Now, as Priscilla said, I'm a historian who dabbled in international affairs. Most of my own work is work I do as an archival historian. I like to work in archives and collections, and I talk to people who use these collections or have their own experiences. We try to rely on through oral history in terms of China, Eastern Asia, and contemporary international affairs. But I also try to move from there over on to what I think is important for us to discuss about where things are moving at the present. Now, I'm not in a particularly privileged position to do that as a historian. Historians, like everyone else, ought to have a view of their own contemporary era and about where they're moving. But no one should say that being a historian you have a particular privilege to talk about this. But you may have a different approach, a slightly different point of view, place of view, you know, to having studied the past. I generally tell my students, certainly my current students at home, that the advantage you get from studying the past is not so much by being better prepared to tell people where the world will move tomorrow, but it does help you, I believe, asking some of the right questions. And studying the past will do this overall. It conditions you to think about contemporary affairs and about the future in a slightly different way, I think, than what would be the case if one hasn't come to emphasize, or at least try to understand, some of the past. So this will to a very high extent influence what I have to say here today. This is about today's situation with regard to China in international affairs and the trends in a broader sense, with an eye on the past, with an eye on where we start off. And the most important thing, I think, to underline, and I've said this again and again in the lecture series that I've done here, it is impossible when you deal with a country like China to sharply differentiate between the domestic and the international. China is too big, too complex, there is too much history in the country for that to happen. Very often one finds, when one looks more closely at things in China, that the domestic is international and the other way around. One of the general concepts of China that I've battled against throughout most of my professional career is this idea of China as isolated. I mean, there have been almost no period in Chinese history, as I can think, where China has been cut off from the rest of the world. I mean, maybe during the peak of the Maoist madness of the 1960s and the 1970s, you can something along these lines. You may have got it at, you know, during a couple of reigns of the Ming Dynasty. But it's uncommon. It's extremely uncommon. China has always been linked into the rest of the world, and the rest of the world has been connected to China in various forms. So, as I argue in a book I published a few years ago on China, Restless Empire, today's China is in many ways a hybrid, more than most other countries that I know. A hybrid of the deeper traits in its own history and the international impact that has come in, mainly in the form that we see it now. It's Frank Dickerton, who is here, has been covering some from the late 19th century and throughout the 20th century, particularly through what he so correctly has termed China's age of openness in the early 20th century, when China was more open, more receptive to what was going on elsewhere, but the rest of the world also interacted with China than we have seen probably at any other point during the recent history. So, when we look at the future as well, try to move away from this idea of the sharp divide between the domestic and the international. I think that really helps in trying to understand where we want to go in terms of possible questions. Well, I do think that we have to differentiate, and this will be part of the core of my talk this evening, is between different forms of issues and questions that link us into what we want to discuss about China's future, or possibly China's multiple futures. And there are three forms of issues that I'm particularly preoccupied with. Here I will insist a little bit later on a fairly sharp differentiation among these. So three forms of issues. The first one is what you could call structural trends in a broad sense. So structural trends like demographics, like education, like culture, like communication. These are things that we can say a great deal about, not just about what the situation is today, but we can, I think, say something meaningful about what the situation will be like, let's say, up to half a generation. We don't always get that right. But at least we have the basis for saying something that is meaningful about these kinds of issues. And it's possible to think about them in a broader context. Think, for instance, about demographics, which, as I've said before, is going to have a very strong impact on China's future. China is the only country that I've ever come across which at this stage of its development will have, within the next generation, a rapidly declining population by a political decision that was made by the Communist Party, I think, maybe for all the wrong reasons, now a generation ago. But that we know. There's not much that the Chinese authorities can do about this, even though they now have opened up for people having two children, which I think on average is not going to happen. But even if the government mandated, which wouldn't be entirely beyond, that every family had at least three children, even that wouldn't make much of a difference in demographic terms. So demography, we know something about, just to use one example. Then you have the second form of issues that I'm preoccupied with tonight, and that's what you could call structural uncertainties. the bigger issues that are going to influence China's future and the rest of us, about which there isn't really all that much that we can say for certain, except that these are going to be involved. They are going to push in one direction or another that is going to be pretty decisive for what we're going to see in the future. So these are issues such as economics, big issue that I'm going to talk more about in a little while, international links, political structure, not least, and a lot of what I'm going to have to say tonight is about governance, but also about what you could call state structure, the form, the shape of the state, which is something that I've written quite a bit about recently with regard to China in a historical context. So these are the structural uncertainties. We know that they matter, we know that they are important, but we know relatively little for sure about how they are going to be turning out. And then you have what has been termed black swans. The kind of issues where the future is so uncertain that it's very hard to observe from where we are today the direction that they will be going. We are aware that there are huge problems connected to these areas in China, but we have very little idea about how they are going to turn out. And this is perhaps where the biggest problem with studying China today and in the immediate future is. That there are more of these potential black swan events for China than for many other countries that I know. So the future in that sense is much more uncertain. And certainly much more uncertain than you get the general impression from listening to the Chinese authorities, or indeed, I would say, to listen to a lot of people, particularly in the wonderful science of economics, thinking about China in the future outside of China, here in Hong Kong or in Southeast Asia, where we'll be going next week, or for next. And what makes these issues so problematic for China is that they cover some of the core areas that any country, any political unity will have to deal with successfully in order to do well. They include key issues such as governance, such as social stability, such as regional crisis. There are many big and important countries in the world that you can say about that these kinds of core issues are deeply uncertain in the immediate future. I'm going to draw some comparisons later on so we can talk more about that also in discussion. But that is my contention, that these are more uncertain for China than for almost any other important country. So let me try to look at this then with this differentiation between structural trends, structural uncertainties, and black swan events, a series of events, with regard to some of the key issues that China will have to deal with in the immediate future. And let me start with the one where I think that for most of us, at least those of us who are in any way invested in global markets, I have the most positive message probably about this, and that's with regard to economics. A huge number of uncertainties in terms of where China's economy is going to go over the next half generation, so the next 15 years or so. And there are some very negative trends that we have seen in this country. The biggest concern that I have about the people who work on this app is not so much with the economic structure, even though there are problems there as well, significant problems, for instance, in terms of state-owned enterprises and their various difficulties. But with regard to the overall debt and situation in China, debt has become much more of an issue in China over the last generation or so, and is probably now at unsustainable levels. But will this mean that the Chinese economy is going to collapse, or even that there will necessarily be a hard landing? I'm not so sure of it. I think in China, more than most other countries that I know of, economics will to some extent be governed by the political and by the governance issues. So if these things do collapse, for which there is a responsibility, then of course China's economy will also be neutral. But that in structural terms, the Chinese economy in and by itself, even within the global trends that we are seeing now, but also very soon, is heading for a rapid fall, is something that I'm doubtful about, or I'm at least as doubtful about that as I am about these kinds of collapses in other economies that we know. It is, of course, entirely possible that the whole global economy is going to go to hell in a handbasket, but if that happens, then all the cards are off the table. We can talk more about this later on, and I'm going to mention a couple of my real concerns about the Chinese economy in a little bit, but this is my sort of general take. When we move to governance, however, we are in a different situation with regard to China. So I taught a course at the Kennedy School this past fall, with, as all our courses have, a fair number of Chinese students in it, from the mainland, from Chinese from other parts of the Chinese world, and people of Chinese origin who moved abroad. And we spent a lot of time discussing governance in China, political structures, and I learned a lot from those discussions. I mean, it's very interesting to have other people's views, particularly people who are of a younger generation, more observant than what you are yourself, or looking more closely at some of the issues that are there. I think where we ended up was focusing very much on governance for one reason. And that reason is that the overall impression, I think all of us have, is that China's biggest problem is that it is very badly governed. So how can you say that? You know, we are looking at an American election campaign that is slightly unedifying. A lot of people, including people from my native European parts, would say, is this a way to run a country? Is that a way of selecting new leadership? Politics in Britain is not necessarily that inspiring either. Question in Britain, of course, whether the country in its current form is going to exist beyond next summer. So others have difficulties as well. Why do I single out China with regard to this? But let me try to do the comparison with regard to the United States. So, if Donald Trump were to be elected American president, we can hope and pray that that doesn't happen, but if he actually is elected, there will be, I foresee, significant difficulties in terms of governance overall within the United States. But it's very, very unlikely that even such an event would destabilize the American political system as such. And I say that in part based on American history for the past generation or so. The resignation of one president, the difficulties that have been there in many presidential administrations in the United States. The deadlock that has existed in Congress for a very, very long time. The United States is capable of surviving these kinds of crises because its system of government, its model of government, in spite of it not delivering for a huge number of Americans, still has a basic legitimacy, a basic acceptance among most Americans who bother to take part in the political process. That is not the case in China. The more you look at the way China is governed, the clearer it is that a very large number of people, for different reasons, do not believe that the current form of government is optimal. Quite on the contrary, they feel that it's not delivering for them. In a structural sense, not just the sense that has to do with the current leadership, but in a form that actually has proven itself incapable of dealing with some of the broader structural problems that China is facing in what you could call the late reform era from 2000 or thereabouts. And this is a huge problem. I mean, when you have a country that has been so tremendously successful, in terms of completely redoing its economy that China has been over the past generation, where the vast majority of people still are deeply uncertain about the core legitimacy of its political system, and where that, in my view, affects day-to-day governance in China on issues that are very broad and very significant, then you have a real problem. And this is a problem that is going to influence China's future to a very, very high extent. So, thirdly, let us look at what you could call social and possible sort of ethnic stability in China, which is something that the current government, of course, is very preoccupied with, but which also links to the two issues that I've been dealing with already, economics and governance. Now, if I'm right that China's real problems in the foreseeable future are going to be political, but specifically economic, even though two are connected, then that has a tremendous influence on the issue of social stability. If the current regime gets into serious trouble, which I think is very likely in the next couple of generations, for political reasons, that will touch on social stability to a very direct degree. Now, I phrase this in a particular manner, as you will have noticed. I'm not sure that the difficulties that the Chinese government will end up in, it's are necessarily coming out of social instability in itself. I think it is quite likely that in the next round, it will be the other way around. That its instability within the political system, the way it is now construed, the sense that it is not able to deliver, even for the people who are currently working within it, that could lead to difficulties elsewhere. Now, it's quite likely that these two directions will come together. When I'm asked, particularly in China, which does happen quite frequently, how I think this regime is going to go, I think my answer is a little bit like Poland in the 1980s. It's a regime that will prove itself incapable of dealing with the most acute day-to-day problems that people are facing, where the political core is fragmenting, and when, as a result of that, you then get mass movements who are literally taking power into their own hands. I think that's the most likely scenario that we are going to see. There are other scenarios as well, we can talk about them later on, but I do see a certain connection. I also think, by the way, just to connect to this, that it's very likely that the kind of social unrest that we'll see in China over the next half generation will come from the Chinese working class. I don't think it will come from the intellectuals, I don't think it will come from university students, at least to start with. We are not looking for repeats of 1989, I think it's highly, highly unlikely. But I think it is quite likely that people, maybe particularly in South and Central China, where workers are exploited more than you find in many other areas, where you know people will stand up and basically say, we are the people in the People's Republic. What about our rights? What about our crucial rights to set up free and independent trade unions? Those are the kinds of things I think we ought to look for in terms of China's future. So, on the domestic, even though I don't think one should go from one day to the next thinking about China's collapse, China's political collapse, that's not how these things work. I think one should be very, very cautious with those many who are saying China is on its way under the current regime to find a new model for government that is going to work better than the more open, less authoritarian, more democratic models that you see elsewhere. I think the opposite is true. I'm not saying that it's impossible for China to move in a different direction than what is happening elsewhere. That's absolutely possible. But that's not what's happening at the moment. At the moment, it is a regime that is stumbling from one crisis to the other and seems to have very little or a direct sense for where they would be going. And where the need for political reform is growing increasingly in this time. Whatever happens in the economic sector, even if the economy suddenly should take off again and be back to 10% growth, which is not going to happen, Even so, China's political problems will become increasingly severe. Let's then talk a little bit about foreign affairs and the directions that China will be taking, bearing in mind the kind of issues that I brought up now, which are the ones that, in my view, are going to determine where China is going to end up, also on the international level. I've said often during this series of lectures that to me, first and foremost, China, in its international orientation, is dealing with Asia. It is its near abroad that is going to be the main orientation for China's foreign policy for the next half generation, probably for the next generation. The idea so often proclaimed, particularly a few years ago, of China taking over the world is nowhere near the picture that I see of China. China is not going in political, diplomatic, strategic terms to take over the world anytime soon. It's not even going to be predominant within its own region, unless it is able to find a handle on some of the issues that I talked about in earlier lectures in this sense. Because China's biggest problem at the moment, and it's a particularly big problem when you think about the domestic determinants that I talked about already, is that it has far too few friends and far too many, if not enemies, have been skeptics in the region where it's trying to be the predominant center. So, from Japan and Korea to Southeast Asia, to South Asia, to Central Asia, and with a possible question of Russia, which I'm going to talk more about later on, China is not operating within a friendly environment. And some of the Chinese emphasis, which I talked about in my last lecture, on a very new and rather extreme form of nationalist thinking, gets in the way of building the kind of friendships that many of us, myself included, thought that China was moving in the direction of during the Deng Xiaoping era. Think, for instance, as I dealt with in an earlier lecture, on Southeast Asia. Deng's greatest breakthrough, he says this himself, was not so much normalization with the United States, not even building a workable relationship with Japan. It was completely turning around two generations of enmity between the key Southeast Asian countries and China, and creating what seemed for a very long time to be almost a kind of political and economic miracle in terms of working with the countries to China's immediate side. Now, within less than a decade, the current leadership has thrown all of that. Not just a bit of it, but I would argue almost all of it. Creating a relationship between itself and the leading countries in Southeast Asia, which in terms of perceptions at least, is not all that different from what was the case back in the bad old 1970s. And why has it done this? Well, we can discuss this later, but I'm not going to repeat what I said in earlier lectures. But the main driving force in it is a kind of naive Chinese nationalism that emphasizes territoriality over all other goods in terms of international relations. For a country at China's stage of development, that is a bad mistake. And it's a mistake that is going to have dire consequences, I think, for China's opportunity to deal with its neighbors. When it links with the United States, which I spoke about in my first lecture here, I have been, and I am, more positive in terms of the bilateral relationship. The reason for that is, of course, that in terms of international economic affairs, which has been at the forefront of China's global strategy, if you call it that, there are relatively few conflicts in bilateral sense between China and the United States. Almost all of the real issues that divide the two have to do with China's regional role within what you could call Eastern Asia in a broader sense. Now, I'm not here foreseeing that we could not see, for instance, under the next American administration, more issues of a global kind that would come up to the at the moment, that is in a rather spectacular fashion when you think about how much unease, uncertainty, lack of trust there is between the two, that is not the case. The issues are Asian, they are connected to China's neighbors and to neighborhoods around China. And that, of course, also would make them, under best of circumstances, easier to manage than global conflicts. This is not a Cold War scenario, whatever way you draw it up. This is not two superpowers that are confronting each other globally. I'm not saying that any of these issues, East China Sea, South China Sea, relationship between China and India, the relationship between China and Korean Peninsula, which I'm going to talk more about later on, that any of this is easy to deal with in the relationship between the United States and China. But it's possible to deal with. These are regional issues that can be dealt with if other circumstances pushes both countries in the direction of actually attempting to deal with them sensibly. But this also connects to my final point in terms of overall foreign affairs, and that is what you could call China's sense of purpose in an international sense. And it's actually what I'm going to discuss up in Shanghai tomorrow and day after. The question there is, what kind of strategy does China want to have for its regional position and eventually, over a very large period of time, for its global position? Does it want to accentuate specific positive values of its own, or is being, as one American China expert put it recently, is being a spoiler enough? Is it enough for China simply to say, we do these things because we're not the United States and we want to stand somehow for Chinese values in international affairs and in the region in a global sense? Is an insistence on ideas, concepts, such as sovereignty, non-interference, is that good enough? I don't think it is. I mean, I think one of China's biggest problems is that it has to define what it actually stands for, not just what it is against in terms of international affairs. And that has not happened yet, and it's unlikely under the current regime, in my view, that it will happen at any point in the immediate future. Now, of course, as we know, and this is where history really plays a very significant role, this kind of development, if it were to go from a more spoiler kind of position over onto a position of more positive contributions, of course, doesn't just depend on China. It also depends on how China is encountered, what kind of issues that are developed in a cooperative sense between China and the rest of the world, and especially the United States of America. So I'm not saying that this is just a Chinese problem, but I think in many ways, at least in terms of its accentuation and its presentation, it has to start from China. It has to start with the Chinese government expressing its values, its ideas more clearly. Now this of course connects to the bigger questions. I said that it doesn't just depend on China. I think it's important in the final lecture in this series to underline this. Far too often, China is presented, if not in isolation, at least just in a context that is so centered on China's immediate past and immediate future that the rest of the world that it operates in is forgotten. The question of what kind of China we are going to see a generation from is intimately connected to what kind of international state system we are going to see over the next generation, towards the middle part of the 21st century. And I think it's important to underline that going on almost everything that we know so far, this is an international system that is going to be more multipolar and much more diverse than what we have seen over the past two generations. The United States, in military and strategic terms, is probably going to remain the world's strongest power up to the middle part of this century. But that does not mean that American power will not be challenged in a host of different ways by other countries that regard themselves as equally well-placed to influence what you could term international society. We've also, of course, see, as we already see, first and foremost through economics, but we also see it in, I think, in politics and technology, a world that is becoming increasingly interactive. So that things that happen in one part of the world will have more immediate effects in other parts of the world, much more rapidly than what we can foresee even in our own relatively highly interactive age. But what that will mean, I think, is that there will be further pressure on the kind of conceptualization of international affairs that's necessary in a period of very rapid change. And China is right in the middle of this. What you can see as being a contradiction between economics and trade, issues connected to this on the one hand, versus territory, territoriality, and cultural self-identification on the other. I'm not saying that countries can't do all of this, but I do think they have to understand better, and China is a very good example of this, the United States is another very good example of it, how these matters relate to each other. So that you cannot go on insisting, for instance, as China is doing to them, that its role with regard to the South China Sea is better positioned than what everyone else's role is with regard to it, because of matters that have to do with history, with culture, and with a self-centeredness in terms of these issues. That's not going to work in the future. It doesn't even work today, but it's going to work much less a generation from now, where China's nationalism comes up against nationalisms around it that are going to become even more intense than what they are today. So these are issues that we need to be discussed, hopefully more openly than what they are in China today. Now, some of my Chinese friends, colleagues, are saying that there are trends that are sort of moving against them. And one of them is what you could call an increasing regionalization of the world. I mean, my former colleague at LSE, Barry Musalmas, has written a great deal about this in a critical fashion. Will the world of a generation from now be a world of macro regions? Europe, North America, South America, Eastern Asia, etc. I doubt that very much. I think that the tendencies that we're seeing at the moment, and this region is a very good example of it, is that there are too many contradictions within each region to see that happen. Think about the relationship between China and Japan, for instance, which is a very good example. Or think about the relationships between Brazil, Argentina, and Chile, for instance, in South America. So the idea that China would somehow be rescued as the center of what is going to happen in its own region by a global regionalization, I think is unlikely. If China is going to have a leadership position within Eastern Asia, I'm afraid it has to earn it on its own. It has to be able to deliver the kind of goods that others within the region want to see, as I specified in my earlier lectures. Now, since I haven't dealt with this specifically, and that was because Priscilla and I ran out of number of lectures that I should be doing here, I've not been speaking specifically about China and Russia. And I want to do a little bit more on that now. Not very much, I won't go on too much longer. Just a couple of points on this. Russia is a special case in its relationship with China. And I think it could become a rather problematic case. Now, I've studied the relationship between China and Russia in the past quite a bit. I see some of the same weaknesses, to put this bluntly, in the relationship between China and Russia today, as you can see back in the 1940s and 1950s, perhaps in a slightly different direction, with China now being the stronger part in the relationship, but still basically uneven and very, very uncertain in the relationship between the two. Now, some people, again, especially in the United States, are saying what will really be the problem here is that at some point we will see China, Russia's resurgence as an international power, and that would mean more pressure on the pseudo-alliance that it currently is developing with China. I don't think that is the real problem. I'm not looking for any Russian resurgence anytime soon. I think we should be much more worried about Russia's increasing weakness than any Russian resurgence happening in power terms or in economic terms or whatever. The problem for China is that this is a problematic relationship, whatever direction it goes. I mean, even if we are, if I'm right, and we are thinking about Russia's increasing weakness, that could also turn out to be very different in an alliance relationship with China, with Russians feeling more uncertain about overpowering Chinese interest in the relationship, but also just the breakdown of some of the issues, some of the connections that China are most interested in its relationship with Russia. Now, let me try to move to some, just in conclusion, Priscilla, to some of the issues that I think we should try to watch in the immediate future. I know I'm talking about the next year or so, maybe a little bit more, in terms of China's international position. One that I have spoken about here before, and I've become increasingly preoccupied with over the past few months, written quite a bit about it, is the crisis on the Korean Peninsula. I am entirely convinced that we are now entering the endgame with regard to Korea. I haven't said this publicly before, but I've been looking at the evidence that we now have, not least what is coming to us for the very first time to China. It is clear that the situation in and surrounding North Korea is becoming more acute almost by the day. I have never heard Chinese officials, in a relatively open fashion, speaking with such alarm about North Korea as they have over the past few weeks. Now, it's possible that this immediate crisis will pass, but I do think, and this is generally a good sign in international relations that things are changing very rapidly, that the very fact that these North Korea-related crises are happening more and more and more frequently is a sign that things there are moving rather more quickly than what we have assumed. And this will of course mean, at the point when this regime goes, and it will go, that international affairs within the region, and particularly China's international positioning, is going to be put under the spotlight in a way that we haven't seen for a very long time. And as I said before in this series, I don't think China is prepared for that kind of situation. They're huffing and puffing and they're grumbling about what is happening at the moment. They're talking a lot about the relationship between them and the North Koreans, about the younger brother not respecting the older brother, etc., etc. We can see this daily. But there is no real strategy there. And they are still holding back. Though there have been some positive signs over the past 9 months or so, still holding back from dealing effectively with South Korea, Japan, and especially the United States, with regard to the coming crisis on the Korean Peninsula. That's problematic, and it could lead to conflict, dependent on how this regime is going to go. What is striking to me is that if China is seen as not having a real strategy with regard to the endgame, with regard to North Korea, it is very likely to end up as a loser. A losing for China, I think, with regard to Korea would mean a situation that, not in terms of its process, but in terms of its overall content, is not all that different from German reunification. I'm not saying that Korean reunification is going to be anything like German reunification. No, there was problems in North Korea, we didn't have East Germany. East Germany in 1989 was a paradise compared to North Korea today. And the differences between the Koreans are much greater. But what I'm talking about is the security implications for China in a broader sense. When I really put people under pressure in Beijing saying, what is it that you want with regard to Korean reunification? What I hear is sort of mumbling about guarantees and common security arrangements, what are the other terms that are being used, translating freely here, a united solution for the region and Korea. What does that mean? Does it mean sovereignty for the Korean people or not? It probably does at the end of the day, but the longer it takes China to get there, the more problematic this will be. domestically. As I said at the beginning of this talk, I think time in China for serious political reform is running out. I think when we look forward to the 1940 Congress next year, the issue of who are going to be promoted into the Standing Committee of the Politburo is more important than ever. If it is a repeat of the situation that we have now, which is probably the least inspiring Standing Committee that I have ever seen in terms of its composition, then I think that chance for political reform is gone. Is it possible that the leadership group around Xi Jinping will be able to move out of that and at least put some people in who are willing to push not just for economic reform, but also to think about different forms in which China's governance can be strengthened? Yeah, that is possible. His power is strong enough for him to do that if he so wishes. The question is, does he wish to do that? Or is he happy with letting things continue the way they are now, out of fear that any kind of reform would be worse for the party and for the kind of power position that his own cohort has in China? I don't know, but I think that is possible. And if there is no move towards reform, I think there is a real chance that China will start to look increasingly like the Soviet Union towards the end of its days, with Xi not being a reformer, but rather than Xi Jinping and Hu Jintao will share the role of China's president. And that's not the kind of perspective that anyone would really like to see. Now, just in conclusion, Priscilla, let me talk a little bit about Hong Kong, because I haven't done that in this series yet, if I wanted to discuss that a bit. Now, I think it's unlikely that China, under this regime or any foreseeable regime, will deliberately do anything that they think threatens the development and welfare of Hong Kong, with an emphasis on deliberate. And the reason for that is, of course, that Hong Kong is much too valuable for China, more or less with the functions and the roles that it has today. So that's my story. The problem, however, is this. That in a country where, in China, where the government does not even respect its own laws, almost anything can happen without too much premeditation. And I think we have seen that in Hong Kong now over the last few months, that things do happen that are connected to decisions taken, it seems to be rather impromptu, by the central government. I'm thinking about the case with the booksellers and other cases, which could have a terrible effect on people's belief in this territory for its future. Now, if China had a better governance process, it could be as authoritarian as it liked. It could be a fascist dictatorship or whatever. But a better system of governance that would actually make it possible in a strategic sense to think these kinds of things too, then I would be much less concerned. But China doesn't have it. And therefore you can have things happening more or less on a whim that could seriously destabilize the city that we are in now. Now, what can people in Hong Kong do about that? I think there is only one solution, and that solution is to seek the highest possible degree of autonomy under the current system that is established here. And I think the people in Hong Kong are capable, on their own, this has nothing to do with international influences or whatever, to push in that direction. Now, of course, we know what the constraints are. We know that a positive outcome for such a push within Hong Kong will only really have an effect if Beijing is convinced that blocking such an autonomy, real autonomy, will lead to unrest in Hong Kong and will lead to the kind of upset of the apple cart that the people in Beijing are so afraid of. So these things are ultimately connected, and I think this is very important. And that means that all those who are working for increased societal, institutional autonomy, including the students here at Hong Kong University, have my sympathy in what they are trying to do. I think it is very, very important, especially for young people, people of all generations, that they understand the relationship between, on the one hand, emphasizing that geography determines your fate. This is a part of China, and it's going to remain a part of China. But that given the way China is ruled at the moment, the only way forward for establishing a Hong Kong which would be equally prosperous in the future as it is today, is to seeking the highest degree of autonomy that is possible. It's quite possible, even likely, that when we are dealing with a China that is better governed than what the People's Republic of China is today, Hong Kong ought to aim for even greater integration under the general framework that is then established for the country. But that is not the case today. And that's the reason why I think autonomy is on my list in terms of what we should move. So in conclusion, and this is not a sort of overall a very positive message for the future that I have tonight, and I'm sorry for that. I like to be positive and optimistic. I think, as I've shown in some of my own work, I hope I've shown, that China's ability to reinvent itself, to overcome challenges and issues that are there, sometimes much more quickly than what people outside China have assumed, is also capable of dealing with the kind of difficulties that we see today. But for that to happen, I think, not just for people here in Hong Kong, but even more so for people in mainland China, it will mean that they will have to take their own fate into their own hands to a higher extent than what we've seen over the past generations. Economic prosperity as a program is not enough. It is essential to link that with a greater degree of what people will see as security in their daily lives. And we're talking about institutionalizing a Western political system or elections to moral right. I'm talking about a more responsive, more open, more transparent system, which is based on kinds of values that have existed in China in the past as much as in the West. So this is not a call for Westernization, but it's a call for China to deal with the kind of challenges that exist today, both domestically and internationally, in terms of the destinations in its own. Needed, probably much, but it's not needed, in China, Because I see the internal situation, at least the way I find it, of people who are within the leadership groups, who are pretty uncertain about where they want to move and what they want to see each other as being. So, I mean, it's important not to misunderstand what I've said. I mean, I'm not talking here about some kind of communist mastodont on a rampage. I mean, that's not what I'm seeing. I'm seeing a leadership that is inherently uncertain about their own future and about their own country's future. And therefore, they move into situations, such as now with regard to Hong Kong, almost unintentionally, or at least unintentionally in terms of the larger effects of what they're actually doing. So this is what worries me. There is also a striking lack of policy coordination under this regime. So part of the core critique, and I've heard this expressed, of the people who have moved into position under Xi Jinping, is that they want to centralize, effectivize, make clearer the kind of direction that the country ought to be taking compared to Hu Jintao and Jiang Zemin's eras. Almost the opposite seems to have happened, where you have, I mean, you have campaigns that have the corruption campaign, and you have crackdown on people who seem to be dissenters, and you have a strengthening, massive strengthening of censorship, and all of that. But in terms of a uniform sense of direction, there is less of that than what I have seen for a very, very long time. So, you know, is this personality driven? Is it connected to the core groups who are charged with dealing with this really having no answer to the kind of predicaments that they're facing? I don't know. But that's the way it is.
Maybe I misheard, but towards the end, I think you said that Hong Kong should seek the highest possible degree of autonomy. And at the same time, I think you also said Hong Kong should aim for greater integration with the mainland. Are those two contradictory?
As always, Frank, your questions are straight to the point. When I talked about integration, I talked about the future more than the current situation. I mean, now my emphasis would be on autonomy in all spheres, and not just talking about politics, but also talking about integration within Hong Kong itself.
Not integration with the mainland.
No. I mean, integration with the mainland when that is more to the direct interest of people in Hong Kong than what is the case today. But the emphasis now, I think, should be on what happens within Hong Kong itself. This is the only thing I wanted to say about Hong Kong politics. But I do think there is a real potential in this city for people who see themselves as being basically emphasizing the basic patriotic qualities on the one hand, and the ones who see themselves as first and foremost devoted to the values and interests of Hong Kong, to work together on these kinds of issues. I know a lot of people on the so-called patriotic side who are equally worried about the directions that are taken in China and in Beijing as people on the so-called democratic or pan-democratic side. And I think the more people in this city are able to come together to work on these kinds of issues and present programs that therefore will be more acceptable to the mainland, the better it will be for the world.
Hi, Professor. I'm Winston, a PhD candidate at the Politics and Public Administration Department. I just have two quick questions. The first question is, I take it you agree with Professor David Shenbang's view that China will be facing a crack-up without some form of liberalization and increased transparency in the political system? And if so, could you give an example of how China should liberalize its current political system, like give an example of that? And my second question is, since China recently has abandoned Taiwan Yanghui, and they become much more assertive, and so do you think the possibility of a specific threat between China and US could still be possible in the longer distance future, even if you mentioned in the short term there might not be such an issue, but in the longer term, given China's rising assertiveness, do you think that can be ruled out? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Two very, very good questions. On my friend David Chappell's views on China films, I think, as always happens in an op-ed or in a newspaper article, you know, his views come out perhaps a bit sharper than what they actually are when you read his broader work. As I said in the lecture, I don't foresee a collapse of China. I mean, that's not what this is about. And particularly if you put it in the direction, I think unfairly, with the words of what David has said, but some people have, in the direction of sort of thinking Soviet Union, the breakup of the state, you know, that kind of stuff, which I don't think was actually his intention. But even on the issue of state collapse, sort of at the center, what I see is likely to happen is a period in which the current regime will be seriously challenged by others who will develop more and more of their own positions within China as it exists today. I'm not saying, never said, that I think the current regime is incapable of reaching negotiated settlements that would make it possible to open up. Let me say more about that in a second. But I think it's getting increasingly unlikely. And if they are incapable of doing that, then this regime is going to go. And it's going to be replaced with another regime, the contours of which I think we can barely see at the moment. So what should they do? They should open up. They should do so. I mean, this is the reason why they should have started doing this 10 years ago, even more. They should open up in a sense that make people feel that they have more of a stake in their own country. I don't know if you remember that famous hashtag, Nigo, right? Some of you have seen that. Your country, not my country, directed towards the authorities. There is something in that. I mean, that's the way a lot of Chinese are looking at their own country, and that's not good. So, you know, it's pretty clear what they want to do. I mean, and instead they are, you know, what the leadership is trying to do is to lock the issues by endless complaints against people who they accuse of ideological pollution and westernization, and wanting to, my favorite is substitute the Chinese people's political system with the American political system. Entirely nonsensical. I mean, that's not what this issue is about, and that's not what people are demanding. Now, to sit in this camp. So, I sit down the hall from Graham Allison, who is the one who has pushed the issue of the Tacitus Trap more than anyone. And this fall, when I was a poet, we had a fascinating running debate about this, in which I, among other things, accused him of maybe having read Derek and Brett. The first point of the perpetration was, but not really studied the terminal, in which Thucydides sums up what the hell went wrong. So, at the beginning of the first book, he said, you know, the famous formulation of Thucydides' trap, that it was because the two countries feared each other, the Spartans were fearing the rise of Athenian power, that was what at the end of the third volume, Thucydides gets back to this, and he says, what we led to was the way the two countries, the two states, were talking about each other. It was the people endlessly spoke about that made the war come. I'm no expert on the issue, so I'm not sure whether he's right. I mean, historians do this all the time. We come up with one thing at the beginning of our books, and we come up with something entirely different at the end of our books, right? I think that when he had written this, and he had more of a chance to think it through, I think he's more right than that. I think this, you know, this sense of rhetoric that you sometimes find, that China and the United States are bound for conflict or something, by that's more damaging than almost anything else that I know of. Because, as I argued in this book, what we are seeing is that in the bilateral relationship between the two, they are not. I mean, even if you want to take the Cold War as a starting point, which I worked on quite a bit, the relationship between the United States and China today is not a relationship. between United States and the Soviet Union back to the middle. They do not, in spite of the political differences, on the global scale, represent fundamentally different systems. And I find China to be just as, if not more market-driven in terms of its domestic affairs and international affairs than what the United States is. So that would be my answer. I do recognize, I think Graham Ellis and others are entirely right, that the fear of decline, as we can see in American politics at the moment, actually more there than in China, in terms of what is actually going on, drives political conflict. I think that's entirely true. I'm not arguing against that, but I also think one has to look at this point about how political contradictions, political uncertainties are talked about, and how that works.
I'm Peter Chen from this university. My first question is somewhat related to the question asked earlier. Mm. So in view of all the domestic and international challenges facing China, what is your take on this? Will China's rise in the next decade be peaceful? I mean, because as you have mentioned, for instance, there could be a possibility that there would be regime challenges and then the leadership may resort to international conflict and from mishandling other issues. A related question to this is, again, how to interpret China's rise. Is China unique? Should we understand China just like any other great power, and hence we have the tragedy of the great power politics, or is China different? Should we understand China differently? Thank you.
Yeah. Again, very, very good questions. On the first one, of course, will China's rise be peaceful? I don't know. No one knows. I think at the moment, I'm slightly on the pessimistic side, as I said, with regard. It's not that I foresee cataclysmic great power war, but I do foresee an increase in tension, which means that one would not rule out military encounters between China and some of its neighbors. The international affairs conference shouldn't rule anything out, but that's what I see as the most likely. Now, the problem is that if these kinds of clashes happen, it's very hard to see where they're going to end. And that's the reason why one should work so very hard in order to try to avoid it. I'm going to next week, I'm going to Hanoi at their invitation to talk about China's policy specifically with regard to Vietnam. And it's interesting because the first time I got an invitation of that kind, on the contrary, when I've been in Vietnam before, they have been very eager to avoid having me speak of anything that had to do with China. And I think there is a certain sense of change that is taking place there, which makes a lot of people in Southeast Asia, not just in Vietnam, quite concerned about the direction that things are taking. At this point, I've forgotten your second question, which was
China does not have a great power.
So on that, I mean, so far, China's rise in terms of international affairs has been almost remarkably peaceful. There's no doubt. That could be explained in different ways. I think the very successful form of international diplomacy that China engaged in, again, almost miraculously, after the collapse of the Maoist era, played a very significant part in that, although that was also done, of course, recognizing China's weakness at that point and acting accordingly. Is this something that is likely to remain? I think, as a general guide for how the Chinese leadership, certainly the current leadership, want to think about its international affairs, they see it as lasting. But in terms of what is actually happening on the ground, the South China Sea, again, is a very good example of this. This is, of course, not what we are seeing. We are rather seeing a China that now seems hell-bent on throwing its weight around with regard to its weaker neighbors. Now, going to comparisons. That's, of course, and on this Graham Allison and others are employed by it. This is how rising superpowers generally began. Think about the United States in the 19th century. God help us all. I mean, that's not the neighborhood we wanted to be in. If you were Canadian or Mexican or Caribbean or whatever. That, of course, should not be used as it sometimes is indirectly, particularly by some mainland epidemics, when they're really throwing up their hands saying, why shouldn't we? The Americans did it that way, the Brits did it that way, colonized half the world, you know. Well, why shouldn't they? Well, they shouldn't, because generally it's not to your own advantage to act in that kind of manner. And what the 20th century showed was that less and less, you know, that was the case. The more trouble you end up with your neighbors, the more you increase the risk of war. War of a very different kind than what was the case in the 19th century. And you act against the interests of your own people who, first and foremost, will be searching for a good life for themselves and their families. So I think that's the answer. And you do hear this comparison fairly often.
Harry, I think one last question.
All right.
Thank you so much for a wonderfully broadly based, insightful, thought-provoking lecture. Thank you, Richard. One of the legacies of history for all countries, but especially for China, is a widely accepted, sometimes government-promoted, historical narrative, our story. And of course, China's story is a story of national humiliation. And my question is, for how much longer do you think that narrative will hold, given what has to be seen as remarkable Chinese success over the period of reform, economically, diplomatically, militarily. And I'm wondering, I recall that Jiang Zemin in one Party Day speech, I forget what year, came very close to saying flatly that the century of humiliation is over. And yet that narrative doesn't die. So I guess two questions. One, what will it take for it to slowly fade away? And what are the implications if it does not?
Those are very good questions, Harry. Very, very significant questions. And that includes just denoting, you know, when I first started, I was doing this kind of stuff now quite a number of years ago. Your two first books were on what inspired me to do what I'm doing now. So it's a particular pleasure for that reason to have you in the audience tonight. You also, by the way, someone who has underlined those links between the past and the present in a form that to me, and I think many other scholars in this field have been particularly helpful and pointed in the direction of people to go. So, for that reason as well, it's good to see you there. On those two questions, I think it's hard to get away. In terms of a general trend, in Chinese education, including public education, very hard to get away from a concept as soon as it's created. And there are others here who worked more on this than me, Frank also. Concepts, words, phrases, how they are institutionalized. And this is not just true for the Chinese communists, by the way, it's true for any Chinese political movement or regime. And that these almost, we're wrong to say they take on a life on their own, but they become so entrenched that they almost become part of a kind of core identity. And I think that is what has happened with the ongoing century of humiliation. When I was last in Beijing, I was listening to an otherwise really good presentation at the Danish Club, at the Central Baptist Group, about how China uses Chinese authorities use the country's own past in order to instruct people about the key things that really matter at present. But even in that lecture, it was impossible for the speaker to get away from the continuum of a humiliation by foreigners in China's international affairs. So that, for instance, China's right to take possession of the South China Sea and many things around it was somehow connected to what had been imposed on China in the past. But that's a very dangerous form of logic, as you know, everyone else colors. It is quite easy to transform our rhetoric about humiliation, degrading things taken away from it, into a revisionist manifesto that includes more and more of the world around. This has happened repeatedly in the 20th century. I don't need to go into an example of it, and it is indeed very dangerous. I haven't seen much of a sense of this going away. Now, if China were to break up this, what would be the directions that this could take? And what's so interesting for me with the concept of the century of humiliation is the way in which it degrades China's own history. So much of what is happening is explained as being as happening as being negative. It's almost not really carried out by foreigners, it's carried out by Chinese themselves, but happens in ways that the current regime, for one reason or another, does not particularly like. And I think this is the big, this is where the concept of humiliation, in a broad sense, my colleague Chen Jian, beautiful Chen Jian, have been writing very well about this, how it becomes a real straitjacket. In terms of what can be done in the future. So how can one break away from it? I think a lot of this has to do with history education, with how history is actually taught in schools. And on this, the picture in China is not entirely negative. If you read, I'm sure some of you have done, but if you haven't, you should do it. Chinese history textbooks, for instance, for the high school level. You will find that most of them are just plain awful. It's not just that they're bad, they're very bad. They lie about a lot of things that the people who've written these textbooks know are actually different. Yeah? But if you sit in, as I've done on a few occasions, on lessons at good schools, good public schools in China, in terms of how this is actually taught to students, you get a more positive impression. And that means that the teachers at least get some other information than what is in the textbooks, and they are willing to take the risk of actually teaching their students a more comprehensive version of what the past can be about, including in some cases alternative explanations of what happened. And I think that's where the real issue will be. My fear, my nightmare, is that the next generation of young Chinese will come out of this generation being taught a blatantly nationalist, untrue version of China's origins, which will steer them in the direction of future aggressiveness against others, because that is what the past has taught us, right? If we do not stand up for our rights, if we are not forceful, then they will treat us the way they treat us. So that's the worst kind of nightmare. But I'm not saying that could happen, but I don't think it's necessary. And that's perhaps the glimmer of hope.
Yeah. Right, well, thank you very much. I'm glad to finish on at least.
Then I'm getting the opportunity to end on a positive note.
As you know, Arne, most of these lectures, I have run my mind over the list of Hong Kong new souvenirs, which you probably want.
Yes.
I know you're always waiting for an addition to your collection of mugs, paperweights, and other such impedimenta that we give to distinguished visitors, even though you're almost one of us. By now, I was even thinking of tie, but then I realized that you probably. There is a photo of you on the Harvard website in a tie. I was totally amazed and wondered what had happened to me munching.
Well, there's something to do with those.
Yes, anyway. So I ran my mind over things that you can give to the man who has everything, apart possibly. a bottle of wine and a six-pack of beer, which I usually see you're equipped with when you arrive. Same old. I have, in the past, managed to come up with interesting things, such as Jane Woolman, a Jonathan Gesch detective story set in Hong Kong view. What do I do? Now, as you know, I have very few classically feminine virtues. I don't do much cooking or anything. Well, I'm actually good at biting my which seems to be a very good division of labour, while I sit around with a glass of wine and make admiring noises and say how clever they are. But at one stage in my career, I used to do quite a lot of needlepoint. So apparently, King Edward VIII, the one who abdicated, his mom taught him how, Queen Mary. And I realised that I have my frames on frame, and I haven't had time to get a stretch in frame because that actually takes a bit of time. But I do have something in needlepoint, sort of vaguely Scandinavian, vaguely Victorian, brilliant, done by my own fair hands. You have to get it framed yourself.
That's all very good. Thank you so much. This will fit it so well in our new home. It's been perfect. Thank you so much, Miss. And then pull me out.
Well, the show is over. We've been running against the Arts Festival, but we brought you all in tonight. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.